I'll just talk about what I'm gonna.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board. It's actually a specially scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. We'd normally be meeting on Monday. We would have met last night, but there was conflict in the schedule, which I take full responsibility for. So here we are tonight. We're going to talk about our annual town meeting warrant. We want to have that ready to be posted. As part of that discussion, the final budget number Sherry's been working on, both with available revenues, with some strategies around cost of living increases, and we're going to have that discussion tonight. We don't have a recommendation tonight from the Capital Planning Committee, but that doesn't mean we can't talk about capital yet. We have motions. We can begin the reviewing process. And now that the moderator is in the house, this meeting is on. Okay, so what we have for homework leaving, before I start with diving right into the warrant, we were handed a notice from Lacey, who's managing the console back there, that Kinder Morgan looks like it has suspended its process. I don't know any more details than that. Suspended its process for its northeast gas pipeline that's been in the news. So pay attention to that if that's important to you. For some folks, that will be a cause for celebration, and for others, head scratching. I personally don't have an opinion about that. Anyway, any other comments by the board on issues or things before we roll into the warrant itself?
Are we sponsored by Cracker Barrel tonight?
Or? Yeah, sponsored by Cracker Barrel tonight. That is a... There was a conversation prior to the meeting about the name of a restaurant, and it was a 2-to-1 vote. With Sherry weighing in.
It's on Mass Live. Kinder Morgan pulls the plug on Northeast Energy Direct Tennessee Gas Pipeline.
Well, there you go.
Two reliable sources, Chris Collins and Mass Live.
There you go.
Got it. Journalism, as Lacey says. Journalism with a big J. Perfect. So our warrant, we had a couple of items for homework with respect to the warrant. And that warrant has a budget piece, the infamous A, B, C, D, E throughout land swaps. And we'd like to go over those items first of all. So if we look at our pages, Sherry's gone through and has made sure that everything that we have to act on is highlighted, or in this case here, gray boxes. We need recommendations. Prior to the discussion on the individual pieces, since items 3 and 4 are salaries and then the budget, we should probably dive right into the budget discussion. There was a piece here last week that was open item, and it was centered around cost of living increases. So Sherry's prepared a draft budget with 1%, which was the recommendation of the personnel committee.
That was based on our form. We actually haven't officially voted on it.
Oh, on the formula.
It was our formula came up with 1% again.
Got
this
it.
Year. We wanted to essentially do an across-the-board bump up, but we found out our friends across the river are doing a study on salaries, and we're, what are we, like CC'd on it, sort of?
Yeah.
So we'll actually get the benefit of all of that work. Sherry was great enough to run like a 1% and then a 2%, and we're going to meet tomorrow, but I think we're going to look at doing a 2% across the board recommendation to try to, and it's not going to do it all the way, but it's a reasonable enough approach to get us closer to getting all the non-union salaries somewhere between the bottom and the middle, as opposed to slipping below the bottom. And because we essentially want to do that to everybody across the board. And then I guess contractor positions, we'd take that recommendation, and then you have to approach that in each contract. But
so as we look at these here, you look at our sheet, Bob, if you've got both budget sheets, it's number six font, so you might not want it.
We didn't have enough numbers.
Right. So you look at the 2 or the 1.
I wanted to actually look at the scattering of the COLAs are across our staff. I wanted to look at the very bottom, Tom, and see if there was a significant difference between 1% and 2%. Now, it's important to bear in mind, you know, 1% in our total salary of affected staff is under $6,000 total. And 2% is just a little north of that, obviously. So if you look at the two budgets, it's still in the 1.8% range, and it's a whopping 2.9.
Difference now.
Like, not that much money.
$3,615 difference.
Sprinkled, that's between 1% and 2%.
Yeah, exactly, okay. Right, that's your difference.
That still leaves the budget at about 1.8%. And $3,600 difference between the two. And also, I think in the last pages here, on our summary of revenues and appropriation, it allows us to look at the differences and the impact of our excess, our available levy. And you're right, David, it's like just over $3,000. So we're, yeah. And 1%, $29,800 is left in the levy, and $26,254 is left in the levy if it's 2%. Sure, no other changes on the expense side. There were some requests that were expansion of hours, or in the case of some departments, revisiting job descriptions. Those have all been level funded. Is that correct?
Correct. And we did South County EMS. There was a revision to their administrative costs, which I plugged in.
Okay. So as we look at the budget, and again, I look at this because it is our essentially Article 4, $7,209,252 or $7,212,867, the difference being 1% cost of living versus 2%. No other changes in expenses that we haven't seen through the budget process to this up to this date, this meeting. Tom, David, what are your thoughts on the budget itself and the total number? Then we can talk about the 1% versus 2% cost of living increase. We've been through the... go ahead, Dave.
No, it's palatable. A
mm-hmm.
Little bit of a squeaker, but you know, we've been in far worse positions. The only thing we're going to have to keep our eyes on, I think, is like we've all been saying, is going down the road with schools and things like that, and hopefully, you know, well, we're really going to see where they start off their budget year. I think that's going to be, it's one of these budgets where it's okay, but I'm kind of looking more down the road, I think, a little past this one, because that's what the concerns are really starting to get concerning.
Clouds looming.
Yes,
right?
That's the thing that...
Clouds looming.
Right.
Good way to put it. Tom, comments about the general budget number, and then comments.
I know you went to the back page, mm-hmm. but for me, I went to the
page three,
yep. And that to me is kind of the important page because they're all important, but on the page I was looking at. Defines what the town's actual budget it's actually up 3.2%, that section.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't matter if you go 1% raise or a 2% COLA.
Yeah.
The overall budget is a 1.8 because we're stripping debt away.
Yep.
Right now.
Right.
Yep.
So that's why we're losing it. Most of that debt mm-hmm. is excluded debt, so yep. So basically, our tax bills are a little more stable mm-hmm. right now, but we are losing debt, which is not a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good thing. And a lot of the debt was because we had to have it.
To your point, though, Tom, if you look at the operating budget itself. Before wastewater, which is essentially enterprise funded,
right.
User fees, and then debt and interest, we are actually having an increase of $207,549,
which is a total increase of 3.2%, depending on which one. I'm looking at...
They're both end up at 3.2.
I'm here at the 2%, but it's somewhere between there and $3,000 less than that. And that's set against a backdrop of our capacity to raise in new growth of being somewhere under the $140,000 range total. So this budget, effectively, the recurring expense exceeds our recurring capacity to grow.
Yeah, and I will, I don't know how else to say it, we have an increase of $219,000 in the elementary school.
Yep.
That's not sustainable.
Yep.
And
a big one.
And we were at the public hearings. I don't know how much room that they had to do anything. But at the same time, 219,000. I know the state said we were a little shallow on the, they said we weren't paying enough. So I understand that was like 50,000, 50, 60,000. I understand why we got the 219 because some in classes are increasing. The student population is increasing, so we have to add an additional classroom. But at the same time, 219,000 is tough. 90. And it was helped along by the $90,000 less to the tech school because we have three students less.
Right.
And then again, you figure $30,000 a year to send the kid to tech school, that's pretty amazing.
Mm-hmm.
But that number varies for every town. Some towns pay much less. Many towns pay more. So Frontier budget was up a considerable amount also this year. They used $250,000 out of their E&D. If they don't use that again next year, that's what happened to us a couple of years ago when they were adding 140, and then they didn't. You put that 140,000 in, that was a bad thing also. So, I mean, and when I say that, is that I can pretty much look at the contracts that we have signed with our unions, and they're all getting pretty much around 2% anyway. So why are we treating our town employees, why would we treat them differently?
Mm-hmm.
They work as hard as the people that ride in police cruisers and teach and the instructional aides and staff at the school. So why... And when we were having very hard times, who were the first ones that we took the money on? We didn't even ask them.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, it's never much fun on that side when you're looking at the removal of people's salaries.
Yeah. So, I don't. For me, I would like to say once again that I still say. Just the percentage increases is a failed, flawed, inaccurate method of giving pay raises. Mm. It'd be the big accordion. Right. The guys at the top get more and the guys at the bottom get less.
Yep.
So I would hope at some point our personnel committee would look at maybe looking at jobs. Instead of looking at what other towns are doing, hourly rates and stuff, I would hope that they can look at the jobs and try to put down a number, and maybe one year the police chief gets $1,000 raise, and the town clerk gets a $3,000, or the selectman secretary gets a $3,000, not a COLA increase, but to bring those numbers where they should be.
Collapse the accordion again.
Because the high end gets bigger. Increase in the low, and I don't see, and again, I've been saying that for years, so.
Mm-hmm. So as we talk about the warrant itself, there's no values plugged in. That's in the form of the motion. We have the elected officials piece, again, that reason for holding off on the warrant on the elected and Article 3 and Article 4 is we haven't decided on this piece yet. Is there consensus about the 2% cost of living increase across?
Confirmation 2%.
Okay.
Let's not belabor this point. 2%.
Okay. So.
Second.
Do I have a second? Let's move this along.
There you go. So we get a recommendation for 2%. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. So next up is the final budget number, right? Our final budget number recommended is coming in at 7 million. I got to make this one go away because I know I'll cite it at some point.
I know, right?
So I just will. $7,212,867. That is an aggregate of 1.8%. Any discussion? If not, is there a motion?
Well, we have a letter here from the Finance Committee talking about the police chief wages. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, we probably should. Dave, you want to go ahead and talk through that?
Yes.
It's an email thread. So there's a Finance Committee meeting last night, last night, and they sent us article.
There you go. Yep, that was one.
Sent us recommendations on the budget update, warrant articles, reserve fund transfers, kind of business. But and their fifth point was about the following.
The SFC, the Sunderland Finance Committee, has voted 4-0 to raise the police chief wages to $72,000 from the requested $65,000. Bruce Bennett made the motion. Excuse me. We made the motion that we do this as we're finding it hard to find candidates for the open police chief position. And they reviewed the FERCOG salary project and found that among similar towns, we are on the low end of the ranges.
Okay, discussion. With regard to this, the Finance Committee requesting an additional $7,000 be put in that salary line. Tom, what do you think?
Well, I know that our wages, I mean, we just went through this negotiating with the town administrator, that the town administrator wages that we had were on the low side. And again, it goes back to 9 years ago. And I don't know if I'd go to 72, but I think that there should be some increase that allows us some flexibility when we go to hire. So you don't have to come back to a special if you have to follow some other number.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go to a higher number and not have to pay that number either.
That's true. It can be a maximum in that sense.
Correct.
Yep.
David, what do you think?
Yeah, after having the meetings with the Personnel Committee, it seems like all of our non-union positions have slipped well below. So I think I would be in support of that. I think as part of an organized effort to take care of that across the board, but within a reasonable means that we can get in our budget.
Okay, so I have reservations about plugging in a salary change at this point in the budget process. And I have even stronger reservations about doing it onesie twosie across individual jobs without a holistic view. I understand the struggle of trying to attract, quote, qualified people. I assume in the marketplace, in the municipal setting, with an advertised salary range, that we're going to attract enough applicants to conduct interviews for all of our positions. That doesn't mean we're in the best possible stay against our competing towns. There was a fair amount of consternation when a library came forward and in this part of the process and said, you know, we want to revisit an individual position. In this case here, to your points about being able to have that as a line item and use it to negotiate, that's, I understand the strategy completely. I do struggle with two things. First, this time of the budget process to do it. And secondly, although we know it's been hard to attract, we know it's been eye-opening to have applicants look at our salary range, case in point, not to pick on you, Sherry, look at our salary range and go, wow, huh, hmm, I have to rethink this, and have long conversations and the commitments made. I am reluctant to plug this in on the recommendation of the Finance Committee, nothing against the Finance Committee, without it going to the personnel and without a holistic look across the board. I would suspect the town would have its eyes opened if we came forward and asked for, after a full review of, and I'm making a number up, $25,000 or $28,000 in salary adjustment because we've done all of our homework and we bring that forward to town meeting. This, in some ways, is a way of backing into it one job at a time. So I struggle with that. That's my piece. So if just to put this back in the numbers perspective, if we add $7,000, we still have capacity in our levy limit. So we would be in the $19,000 to $18,000 range. We'd be in the $20,000 to $19,000 range. Right, we're at 26 and 27. So in that range. It's not like it's going to push us forward, but remember, this becomes an opportunity, not that it's budgeted, not that the budget is a commitment, a contractual commitment. It is a potential for recurring expense going forward. So that's my two bits. What's a prerogative of the board?
Is that going to be in the study that we're getting?
Yes.
The police chiefs? Because ideally, that's what we want to do on the personnel committee, is kind of approach the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason we went with just the library ones the last time is because we didn't have numbers to be able to base the rest of the stuff on. So I definitely agree that the position needs to be adjusted, like a number of ours. But it would be nice to do a package so that at least if we can get a whole look at it and maybe say, all right, maybe we can't bite it all off in 1 year, at least we can come up with our number and then figure out how we're going to get to that.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
I think that's the...
Doc, go ahead.
I think there's a huge difference between the library and this. Whoever becomes our chief of police did not participate or in setting their salary or agree to the job yet.
I agree with that.
Mm-hmm. The library set the positions. They're the ones that came to us with the rate. We didn't establish what the rates were.
Correct.
The library trustees are the ones that hired that person.
Yep.
We didn't hire. We're not hiring our other positions now. We're hiring the chief of police now.
Uh-huh.
I can't change the fact that the personnel committee or whatever, whoever, hasn't had the opportunity to review the entire town. I do understand that we're in the process of hiring a chief administrator of our police department, mm-hmm. and that we should have the tools available in our tool belt to be able to, for the right candidate, offer a competitive salary. That's all I'm saying. Mm-hmm. So I don't quite see. And to tell you the truth, I mean, the personnel committee, you can look at all the kind of studies in other towns. How many towns chief of police is actually as a working, you know, again, is he a working chief? Does he do 24/7? Can he do details? There's a lot of things that are not included in a salary study. A town clerk, at one time, a town clerk, and Cherry probably maybe able to help me with this, a town clerk could keep fees for certain things, right?
Tax collector too.
So you could pay the town clerk $5,000, but the town clerk could collect $17,000, $18,000, $20,000 in fees. That didn't happen in the town of Sunderland, right. But it happened in the other town. Sure. But when you went to look at the town clerk's fees, it says $7,000.
Right.
Well, what about the other 13 right. that the town clerk received because they collect fees?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying fee studies are nice. if you've ever been in a contract negotiation with the MTA, the MTA always compares Frontier to Long Meadow.
Yeah.
Grafton, and we, on our side, we compare it to Pioneer, Greenfield, Montague, and what, who's right?
Right.
You know, statistics are fine. I say we have the opportunity to say, again, there's nothing says that we have to spend the money.
Mm-hmm.
There's absolutely nothing that says we have to spend the money. But if we have some, and I would say, because it's the finance committee is acted upon, one of their members that was on the search committee, and the only thing I would say is that, and people can say what they want, I'm proud of our board, because our board put together a search committee, and we didn't take the members of the thing out back and say, look, this is what we want you to do. They're given complete, and if you want to do stuff like that, you have to listen to what they're telling us. We didn't tell them to pick, you know, whichever one would take the job for the lowest price. We said, go find quality, you know, of the applicants that come. We want you to find the best people for the job. And they're telling us something. We should be smart enough to listen to what's being told to us also.
Good point.
I know.
Piece about the process, Tom, was just that. I could have plugged in names or positions any other way.
We can disagree.
Sure. So prerogative of the board, you want to add $7,000 to the budget?
I'd make a motion to add $5,000. I'd like to go to 70.
That's fine. I'll second that.
Okay, there's a motion made and seconded. Is there any further discussion about the addition of $5,000 to the police chief's salary line? No other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. Two to one, please. Okay, so we've added $5,000 to the total of the two percent COLA budget, right? So we're going to be at 72,212,867 plus 5. Siri, how much is that? She never answers when I want her to. So what is it?
7,217,867.
Got it. Okay. Discussion about the other elements of the budget here. The overall expense budget. Sherry's gone through the numbers. Brian's looked at the revenue side. We've had chances ourselves to look at the numbers. The department heads have come through with their process. Any more discussion about the overall budget of $7,217,867? And Sherry, can you throw that in there?
Yeah, I'll update the numbers for you from Monday. Yeah.
Great, thanks so much. There's no other discussion. Is there a motion to adopt the budget?
Motion.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, 3-0, please. So we got a budget here that includes our salaries. That said, I'm going to circle back to the warrant if I could. And I appreciate the discussion about our town's position and salaries. There is a holistic view that's long overdue. Holistic review that's all long overdue.
Are you on motions now, Scott?
No, just we had on the warrant, Tom, we had 3 because of salaries and then 4 because of budget. Is there a recommendation for Article 3, the compensation of elected officials, as is presented?
That reflects the 1% number. So,
well, actually, elected officials historically, with the exception of the assessor,
right? We're not taking.
We have historically not.
Oh, okay. Right. So I.
The only one that changed really is a town clerk.
That's
town
correct.
Town clerk and assessors.
Correct.
Would the town clerk number be?
With the 2%, that number will be.
It's on our spreadsheet.
41,223.
41,223. Ashiri, this board only takes pay cuts. We don't take pay raises.
That's correct.
That's just the way it is.
We only take pay raises when Mr. Sillen.
Russ or Will, right.
Will Sillen.
So, Sherry.
The only ones that I adjusted were the assessors and the town clerk. I kind of followed suit from the last one.
Okay, so as I look at the selectmen, planning board,
those are
moderator, are all level. Okay, so the assessors would end up being with their 2% accordingly. Those numbers would go up. We take them right off of the spreadsheet, which were just voted.
Right. So it's the 8,721 divided by 3.
Okay. Make sure those are right. 8,721 divided by 3. What are those turned into? Oh, calculator. Hang on, Siri. So, $8,021? Hang on, assessors. Assessor salary, 99999. I have 8,721 is a 2%, right?
Yep. And then divide by 3.
3 equals sub 2907 per 2907. Okay, so the assessor salary 2907, moderator 200, planning board chair 660, clerk 660, members 410, and then town clerk 41223. And selectmen unchanged from last year, unchanged from several years, 3275 for the chair, 2850 for the members. Those are the numbers based on this budget we just adopted. Motion to recommend?
Motion.
Sorry.
Motion's made and seconded to recommend. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 3-0, please. Okay, so next up is actually the warrant article, and it has to do with the actual budget. Our motion is going to be including all of the numbers, and we're going to change this piece here to reflect the new numbers, and we can act on that later. We got to get this one posted. Cherry, the council's been through, and it's to see if the town can raise an appropriate transfer from available funds, sums of money for the town and general municipal purposes connected therewith for our fiscal year. We have the numbers inside of the motion. Have we historically had the actual budget number in the warrant itself?
No.
Bob, you remember that? It's been in the motions.
I think so. Right.
What's that?
It's been in the motions right along. Okay.
Right.
Motion to recommend Article 4.
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. You're 3-0. Okay. We have the capital budget, which is developed. And again, this is the same kind of language, sum or sums of money. And Bob, we're going to have handout and we're going to vote the capital budget. And each of them will have a definition, its funding source. And it's a very similar language. This allows us to include language. Hang on, Article 6. Capital budget by source on file of the town clerk.
That would be on your use of cash sheet.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay. Got it. Because some of it is going to be coming from these sources, including CPA, acquisition, borrowing, etc. Okay. Is there a motion to, is there discussion about Article 6 the way it's written? Again, council's been through this. If not, is there discussion?
Did you have to say anything about, we're all set with 5, right?
I think 5 we were all set.
Yeah, 5
we were
all set.
Yeah.
Chris.
Yeah, 5 we had done. So we're on 6, the only shaded one on this side. And again, that's the capital budget itself. And again, our motion matching that. Is the adoption that'll have the values adoption of capital budget amendments by funding source. So this is the language here is catch-all for all the opportunity inside of capital budget.
Right.
Okay. Discussion on Article 6?
Nope.
Seems verbose coming right off of the off of the annual operating budget. Then you look at Article 6 for the capital and it's like, wait a minute, there's like 5 extra sentences in there. It's a little chunkier. Good way to put it.
Yeah.
If there's no discussion, is there a motion to recommend Article 6?
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. 3-0, please. Next up for us on the warrant, we get to the... Go ahead, Bob.
Back to Article 6.
Yep.
Just as a point of clarification, why is capital budget an authorization by...
That is a
eminent domain.
Yeah, that's a mistake. It ran in from the last... article, so I'll delete that. It should end at town clerk.
So you're scratching them into me?
It should end at town clerk, right?
Right.
On file with the town clerk and.
Period, yeah.
Yeah.
That pasted from another article.
That explains the chunkiness.
Yeah.
It did seem.
Authorized.
So I'd like to revisit that. So a motion to recommend.
A motion to recommend as corrected.
Yeah. Good catch, Bob. Tom?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. So now, Bob, take those sentences, and we're going to Article 15. Okay, sure. Have you got the handy, colorful maps? Thank God.
Just one second. We have Article 7, which is for the Smith School program. Do we also have another article to fund next year's also fiscal year?
It's in the budget.
Okay.
Good point, actually.
Last year it wasn't in the budget, that's why we're replenishing the reserve.
Understood. I just want to make sure that.
Great catch.
We're covering it.
Yep. Okay, so 15, A, B, okay. A, this is Article 15. This is the infamous triangle piece. So everything centered around Article 15 is going to be there. Lacey, what do you think? We can get the projector up? What do you think? No, everybody hates that thing.
Or can you zoom in on?
We just hold it? We just hold this.
We should take our laptop and just
well,
plug our laptop into it.
Yeah. If you can
Thank
tell
you.
Me. Yeah.
And we can put that up there. So the discussion last week around the land swaps, the triangle, land parcel A, land parcel B, land parcel C, land parcel D, and three articles, we think is streamlined this week. Article 15 identifies the infamous parcel A, known as the triangle. It also helps and creates, as part of this triangle piece, we have a fund. Let you go. We have a fund of assessed value of $22,000 and change. We have that set aside, and that set aside for interested. Dave, you want to give it a quarter turn so it's the river is where the river is?
Keep going.
Keep going.
Yep.
Ding, 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 ding. Right. Okay.
Perfect.
So that's not exactly 90 degrees, but you're close.
I know. That's how you do it. No, I'm like, get the river on the riverside. That's all.
But Tom wanted the river exactly right.
You know? Well,
it's not quite there.
It's not quite there.
90 degrees more. Though.
It's exactly right. So as you look, there you go. So there you go. So School Street ends right there. So if you see this highlighted piece that's parcel A, this was what the town, through the efforts of the Pathways Committee, has worked on identifying potential heirs of owners for that parcel. This article, not only the mechanics of this article, has the town taking by gift, purchase, eminent domain, or other that parcel. The parcel is 280 feet by 60 feet by 90 feet. I don't have it in front of me, but it's not that big. I do have it in front of me. What that does is it kind of codifies the piece as being town property. It's been a bit of a void. And again, there's a fund that was created. It was assessed value of $22,000 and change. There is a value of that money set up as an escrow. This is being funded, I thought, by CONCOM or CPA?
CPA.
CPA money. And that CPA money sits in escrow for a couple of years, 2 years?
Three years total.
In the event people come forward and they say, oh, geez, my name is on that and I'm interested in my 20% or whatever the heck it is, 20 items. So this article talks about A. What you're going to see is two successive articles that come next, and they lead to the final article showing the total transaction. So Article 15, as it's known,
is
I like numbers so much better than letters.
The
letters just didn't do it for me.
I hear you totally. And for me, Tom, colors became important. So
the colors, colors.
Scott, the only thing you needed there was a pie chart. Chart would have been perfect.
Well, you wait till you see the last one. It's pretty close. Actually, so we're in a position right here to identify that as a town parcel, and this is in regard toward making a more robust boat ramp. And also tying together some trails along the river. That's our next article. So Article 15 is this right here.
So basically, in a nutshell, Parcel A was assumed to be the town's.
Assumed, yep.
But through further research, we found that it was assumed to be owner undetermined.
Yep.
But then under continued title research, we found out who the original landowners were. And now it's looking at 20-plus people.
Right. Yeah, that's quite a few.
There's a number of people, estates that belong to that family.
Right.
And we've had people that we sent letters to Texas. All over the country. Texas, and some still here in Sunderland, yep. But all over the country they get to.
Texas, North Carolina. Yeah,
there's been all. So, and so basically what this will do is give the town title to that access to the river,
yep.
Which we thought we had all along, but we really didn't.
Good point. And what is the historical email describe this as? The Bermuda Triangle?
There was
so much mystery surrounding it.
Isn't there something, there is something known as adverse possession, which states that if you openly use a parcel of land for over 20 years, you can petition the land court.
Right, to take ownership
of that parcel.
Hmm.
Well, that's interesting.
Oh, okay, and you're probably right. The thing is that we're using CPA money because it's going to be recreation.
Right.
And we get a 1-to-1 match with the state, so there's $22,000. So out of town's fund is going to be $11,000, and I can guarantee you by going to land court, we're going to spend more than $11,000. And thank you for bringing it up, because someone can also say, well, how about those people that are now taking ownership? Why aren't they paying back taxes?
Right.
And
right.
We could. You could ask them to pay back taxes, but you could only go back 3 years for back tax. Yep. I believe it's 3 years, isn't it?
I'm not sure.
There's a certain number. I think it's like 3 years of back taxes also.
It was the fairest and cleanest way to resolve the murky situation, I think.
It's a friendly taking.
Yep, exactly.
It's called a friendly taking.
And then, that's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
And look, you don't want to have to use eminent domain unless special thing. Mm-hmm. And this is just so much, it's easier.
Everybody's in agreement in terms of the value of the parcel?
Yes.
It's our appraisal. We had the appraisal done. We didn't really think it was, we didn't think it was going to come out that value, so it was higher than what we thought. And the other people that were, the people that own it, they're fine with it. So, but the person that did the appraisal, we have used in the past, and they've always given us good numbers. So there's no reason to think that's not a good number now.
Good point, Sam. Thanks for clarifying. So that one there we had 3-0. That was a pretty clean one. And I think the graphic is going to be important both for this discussion as well as for town meeting's discussion. The Article A is pretty clean. The next step, you're going to see the next two articles. Bob and members of the board, if you look at Article 16 and 17, they are going to be in reversed order. So Article 17 we're going to talk about next. It will be on the warrant for posting, Article 16.
It will be Article what?
16. Right now, 17 and 16 need to be reversed, correct. And the reason for doing that is that the Article 16, as it was going to be known, has to do with Parcel B. And Parcel B is right this one, right there.
Or you can see it's the white one in that.
So as you
that's
look,
the next,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, good point, Jerry. If you look at right now, A is colored.
Here, I'll swap this one out.
B is the hatch mark.
B is right along the river, Dave. You got
river's
C. Yeah, river's pretty close.
Okay.
So if you look at the corner.
There.
Right, if you look
just
at the.
Just that small piece.
Just that small piece, yeah. That's right.
I'll leave my pen on it.
And so in this case here, Board of Selectmen acquired by gift, purchase, eminent domain, recreational, general purposes, land known as parcel B, entitled and approved. And again, this is another piece that is purchase. Okay? And the reason for having that parcel separate is because of the next article. We have, as part of the discussion, that little piece right there is a standalone article. By having it by itself removes some measure of complication for what's coming up. So Article B we'd like to have by itself. That said, is there a motion to recommend Article, what's going to be 16?
Motion. Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. 3-0, please. Now, the whole plan. Here you go.
This one.
So Bob and members of the community and board that are watching, participating, Article, what's going to be 17 is what's referred to as the land swap.
The one, Scott, that we need to insert shown as parcel B and parcel D.
Okay. And that is going to be right in the second sentence. It says, to see if the town will vote to discontinue a portion of School Street, a public way, which portion is approximately shown as parcel D, right? And B.
And B.
Because School Street continued through, right? So as you look at this piece right here, you're going to have, actually, David, maybe we can put the other one, the last one.
So you're looking
back
at the crosshatch
yeah,
section.
Yeah, if you could put that one back up, just right.
Parcel D.
Right? So parcel that's being discontinued is a crosshatch, right? So here we go. We're going to discontinue A and the parcel that's B. We're hoping to, as the article continues, we're hoping to have this turn into a land swap where A is owned by or transferred to owner of the property that owns C from the town. And that allows us A, B, and C. So the landowner gets the orange, the current landowner gets the orange, which is a town way we want to discontinue, and the town gets B and C. Now, David, if you could flip them around, and that's what the town ends up with. In total, when we're all said and done here, the hash marks stay with what used to be known, or used to be the old Ahern house. It's been sold. We're negotiating with the landowners, and A is a clean taking, B is part of the discontinuance, C is the one that says river path. We're hoping to get from the current landowners in exchange for the area that's discontinued. And the blue represents, at that point there, a contiguous piece out to all the way to the ball field. So Riverwalk pathway is part of the discussion. There's nothing here other than, nothing here that's etched, other than the boat ramp. But we're looking to make that part of the pathways group. And we just got pinged from someone I'm sure is watching. It's all good. I hope the explanation is clearer this week than it was last. And I want to thank the Pathways Committee for, you know, putting it in color and putting it in stages that match the actual warrant articles, because there are three specific articles here. Go ahead, Dave.
Now, does this map address the issue that was raised by Rock last week?
Yeah, that little piece.
Yes. Yep,
it sure does. That's what B broken out is.
You notice on D, instead of D is not a rectangle, it's kind of a
swale,
a polygon.
Yeah.
That on the west side. That was originally a straight line,
right.
But notice how it's got the curvature to it right now. That we get that bank and be able to get around that.
Yeah, essentially turning radius of sorts. If you're looking at it that way versus 90 degrees.
Right.
And basically, right now this is going to cost the town $22,525, and we have some money coming from
A settlement
of $18,000,
right.
And the DCR is going to do the, once we gain title, DCR is going to build a boat ramp and parking and everything.
And those fees actually come from fishing license fees.
Fishing and hunting license and conservation. So, and again, it's another example how you can make CPA work for you.
Good point.
It's, and again, CPA, we get 50-50, right now it's a 50-50 match for the state.
Yep.
So if you look at what we get for...
You're getting more bang for your buck.
Yeah, and that's not included the Pathways Committee.
The initiative, right.
That they put right. into it, which has been an amazing amount of time, so...
Yeah, when you look at what it's going to do for the town down the road, it'll be very nice. Fits into our long-term plans.
Bob? Will there be map or a projection so that...
We're thinking colored right? handouts or projection. We could do it one way or another, but something that's going to be in town meeting.
You'll have something so that...
Absolutely.
The Pathways Committee's working on putting a presentation together.
Okay, great.
Yeah, it's taken me 3 meetings.
If we can project it, it would be good because we'll save the money of having to print all those color copies, mm-hmm. you know, because we got what?
Lacey's already on it.
5, 10,000. We'll have like 5, 10,000 people there right. easily. Think of yeah. all those copies we got to hand out, you know. But the projection will be good, though, because, you know, I think you'll be able to see the color and people can get up and point to it, too. You know.
To echo Tom's point, you know, this was the out of the brainstorming of a really starting as an ad hoc group that had a fair amount of vision and wanted to talk about the walkability, recreational elements, and the total access of the town. And this essentially ends up being effectively their first project.
Yeah.
Right. What ended up being now an appointed body. That is looking a little more holistically at the way we go about the town of Sunderland and what its resources are. So if you looked at this like an APR or something we would do in times past, this is very creative and very, very grassroots. And also credit to the current homeowners who are receptive to the yes, discussion.
Exactly.
Yeah. Just something to think about. If that area gets developed,
mm-hmm.
what about liability? Does that increase our exposure? Or
you're not building a lot of infrastructure. I'm not entirely sure what they would be, what the liabilities would be, more so than any street or any sidewalk or...
Right.
I'm just thinking yeah. proximity to the water.
Sure. I mean, if we're building a roller coaster, that's one thing, you know. But yeah, you're right. Just, you know, we have public way to the water. It would be interesting to see. That's a good question to ask. Maybe we could ask council for.
There is a special law with regard to recreation and liability, and I'll have that for you
okay.
for the next.
Great. Thanks, Sherry.
Yep.
So that's the 1, 2, 3 articles. This one here is 17. We need to insert parcel B as part of language. It's going to be in the second sentence. Which portion is approximately shown as parcel B and parcel D on the sketch? That's it. Approval not required plan of the rest of the language. We got the B language from council earlier in the day. That said, is there any more discussion about this? If not, is there a motion to recommend?
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. And I think that's it. We have those corrections on the warrant itself.
It was just a couple. Scott, with regard to the consent.
Yep, go ahead with the consent. Sorry, I jumped ahead.
Article 20 was the other one.
So Article 20, Town Council. And Tom, this is a discussion. I think there's a question about transparency, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Town Council says this article is not required on the town warrant. It's town annual town meeting warrant.
Okay.
If it's not required, Bob, the article here says, see the town will vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to act in the best interest of the town to negotiate in order to make changes to South County Emergency Management Services
scams. Have you passed this by Deerfield also?
IMA. I was just thinking about that, right?
Did you talk to Doug about this, Doug Finn?
I haven't, no.
All three towns would have to pull it off, right? Presumably.
Well, it doesn't matter. We have a meeting tomorrow night, so we can discuss this. I mean, we can leave it on. We can always withdraw. We can withdraw it at the town meeting.
At the town meeting itself. Yeah.
At the town meeting.
Okay. So active discussion point. Council's position was that we have an IMA and to annually authorize the town board of selectmen to be able to make changes in the IMA is not the purview of town meeting. It was approved. You have an IMA. You have a board of selectmen. You can negotiate inside of the framework of the IMA. So to have it on here annually, she felt wasn't necessary. That said, does it always make for good politics? It's a simple vote, you know, and it may be in front of a town meeting for someone to raise a discussion about. But we'll do our homework, and maybe we will end up possibly, there is a potential this could be passed over, Bob.
Article 24, too. She had the same comment.
Same comment?
Yeah, and that was...
Just about IMAs.
Intermunicipal agreements, right. The town by the board of selectmen by office is allowed to enter into municipal agreements. The question is, does town meeting have to authorize it annually?
So we're taking that out?
Same discussion, actually.
We've been on for now. Okay.
Right? Huh. It's in the consent article framework, it's pretty... quick, they're bundled, but again, by statute and by council's advice, not necessarily required. Okay, so that said, it looks like we have numbers on Article 3 that have to be changed. We have, and those numbers are the budget that we voted. We have to take Article 6 and chop that paste error in.
Yeah, we moved things around, and I think that got lost in translation. Yep,
make that go away. In Article 16 and 17, in Article 17, the word parcel B needs to be added to the second sentence. And then 16 and 17's order needs to be reversed. So we look at our warrant being Article 15A, Article 16B, Article 17, the land swap, D and E. And that's it. Any questions about the warrant? Fabulous. Thank you. I appreciate the discussion. Okay, motions. Next up is on our agenda. And it's 7:28. The warrant is date sensitive in a big way. The motions themselves, we can go through relatively quickly. We have to put the...
Fix number 3.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have to fix 3.
3, 4, I'll have to fix 2.
3, 4.
Change.
Okay.
So on Article 4, everybody's fine. Did we allow Brian to review this so that we don't have to...
Yes, he'll be in tomorrow, so...
So he's the numbers.
So we don't have to...
No surprises.
No surprises. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Tom, as you look at this, that's a really good point. It's important to bear in mind, even as prior to this... Even prior to the additional $5,000 added to the police chief's salary line, we had $26,254 in excess levy. So we're good. We'd be down to $21,254 of excess. So, Brian, we should be okay with that, but always want to do that. Okay, so we're going to plug the numbers in correct to Article 4. We know we're going to add, can we just start with 3? We know we're going to add change assessors to 2907. 2907 and 2907. We're going to take the town clerk, and I'm copying this right off of the warrant we just voted.
Right.
Take the town clerk to 41,223. Those are the only changes. We know those are coming off of the warrant. Is there a motion to recommend on the motion sheet?
Motion.
Why don't we just go through them all, Scott, just instead of doing each individual?
Yeah.
If we have a problem, let's go through each one.
Sure.
Then do the whole thing.
Okay. So you want to just essentially audit.
Yeah.
And then at the end, one recommendation for the motion. Okay, that sounds good.
That's fine.
So there's really nothing to change on 1. That's hearing boards and committees. Right. There's nothing to change on, I'm sorry, we have a bill to pay on 2, which is free cash. We know that. We just did the math for Article 3.
Can I ask one question? Why don't we have the Smith School and this bill next to one another, since they're old bills.
That's no, a good point. The bill for the legal services is from fiscal year 15. That's a prior year.
Okay.
The bill for Smith is for this fiscal year 16.
Okay. So is that a nine? Do we have to have a
for the Smith Volk? No.
No. That means for the Article 2. Is that 4/5?
That's a 4/5 because it's a prior year.
Okay, that's fine.
4/5. I like that. What's 4/5 metric? Anyway, good question, Tom. With respect to the Article 3, right? Article 4, we have to change the revenue raise and appropriate goes up by 5,000. Actually, let me ask a question, Sherry. With respect to Article 4, is this based on the 1% or the 2?
This is based on the 1%.
Okay. So we have to change the value on Article 4 for the raise.
Yep.
We have to also change the total, which is not going to be 7209 anymore. Beyond that, everything else stays the same.
Yeah.
Aim of the reserve, peg access, overlay, etc. Okay?
Have to add the 5 to that.
Add the 5K. Yep. Add 5K and make 2%?
Yep.
Okay. And again, that's straight raise and appropriate. Next is moving of free cash to stabilization, $103,000. So 103,752, that doesn't change. Article.
When this is all done, how much free cash is going to be left?
We're going to have a potential impact, Tom, here, $67,000. But we're starting with the current format, $471,900.
Okay.
I'm sorry, you said free cash?
Yep.
After all said and done?
$158,826 going forward.
$158,000?
Yep, $826,000.
That's good.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we use a portion of free cash to fund the budget, as you'll see.
Yep, $103,000.
We use $103,000 to stabilization.
Yep.
And we leave $158,000 going forward.
Good. And how much do we have in stabilization left, Sherry?
After the articles are done?
Yeah.
There'll be $471,903.
Good.
That is a point of discussion actually coming up.
Yeah.
With respect to capital. Yep.
All right.
Article 5, we want to move free cash, 103,752, straight to stabilization.
Yep.
And again, that's different this year than in prior years where we would put it in capital. Again, we raise capital now, so we want to put it in standard stabilization. Next up, capital stabilization funding for the capital stabilization budget. So the sum of monies currently, we have a lease for this one here. We're going to have to probably wrap up on Monday. We have a lease discussion for a truck as opposed to a purchase. And we also want to talk about engineering for North Main Street. And North Main Street engineering is likely to be a recommendation that come from stabilization as opposed to capital, in that it's not something you can see, touch, or feel. Article 7.
On Article 6, you going to start talking about engineering for North Main Street?
Yep.
Reiterate the fact that you've got to come up with some money up front so the state will kick in.
Absolutely. You're talking about a $2.1 million project, and to participate in the TIP, the town has to bring forward, over the course of a series of years of funding, 75% designs to put in the pool where the state essentially awards the project. That's how the TIP works. And Sherry, you said 20 and 21 now, right?
Right.
2020 is what we're planning for. I think when we started this whole TIP process, we were talking about 18 at one point, and we get bumped out.
15.
Yeah, 15. So, Bob, when 2021, when you're able to ride your bike up North Main.
Skateboard.
Skateboard. I like it. Yeah. Skateboard up North Main.
Or is hoverboard.
Hoverboard. Even better. Okay, so next up, Article 7, $28,000 for Smith Volk in the current year. That's from free cash. Then we have the CPA articles, appropriate the $50,000 for the Rio fire truck, then 30,
Question on that.
Yep.
Is use of CPA money for non-town
yep.
uses permitted?
Oh, yeah.
Non-municipal.
There was some discussion about that very early on in the CPA when it was created, with things like church steeples in centers of towns, of private buildings, and it went through the court cases and said, well, yeah, it is a municipal use, however it constitutes historic preservation, or et cetera, et cetera.
You'll also notice in here the language has been changed to add the line in to authorize the Board of Selectmen in consultation with the Community Preservation Committee to enter into a grant agreement with the Sunderland Volunteer Fund.
Oh, that makes sense. So
that was council's recommendation.
Smart. Yeah. So they could apply for up to. Good point. Thanks, Sherry. So next up, 36631, undesignated for this space we just talked about. Land acquisition, riverfront, bank, etc. Then Article 10, $52,000 for, again, Tom, we'll circle back to your discussion a couple of meetings ago. Our cemetery, this is a multi-year, just like the riverbank is a multi-year, just like probably the Rio is likely a multi-year plan. This is for a cemetery. And again, I abstain because I'm a trustee. Whether I had to or not, I don't know. Whatever. It just looks right. And then the Article 11 is the CPA Preservation Fund going forward. A little bit of appropriation for administrative assistance. And then debt service, we know that's 120. And then you've got resources, historic community. And again, the reason the community housing is not in reserve is that it's currently being used. So again, you're 10% per, or thirds per. Article 12, free cash, $5,000 for the anniversary 300th, seed money for the 300th. Article 13 is the extension of the work program up to $1,000 a year. We have a senior tax write-off now, a senior work-off program, and this is an extension for veterans and or spouses of the same statute. Sherry, you want to talk to this? It always turns my volume knob up a little bit.
Oh, the PEG access and cable 211. Related.
211.
This formalizes a practice that we're already doing, which is we have established a special revenue fund for the PEG access money that we received through the contract with Comcast. And this is just formalizing that process, which the accountant has advised me that we're already doing.
So a town meeting is going to create the fund that the account that is currently codifying a practice. Essentially, yeah. We need to create a special fund, special reserve fund. Town meeting is the only body that can do that. In this case here, 15 is A, parcel A we talked about. 16 is now going to be 17. It's also going to include the word parcel B prior to the word parcel D. That's the only change. Article 17 is now going to be 16 on the motion sheet. Again, they're being rotated. And there was no changes to that. Article 18 is capital stabilization appropriation. Now we have capital stabilization. This is the clarification from the prior year, Bob. Mm-hmm. And we had in our appropriation last year the correct total value, but we did not include the sum from capital stabilization of 18,814. And all this is clarification. Those monies, the appropriation was completed. We need to clean this again as a request of the accountant, and rightly so. We need to show essentially one element of that total that was not reflected in the original article. This is cleaning up something from the prior year.
19 is the addition to the Library Building Trust Fund, and it is in italics, and to provide funds to equip that new library in the future. That's the only change, and the reason for this is it allows the trustees to expend monies that were part of the library build-out, original library build-out, including some donations that were essentially bundled up in a building element and made it hard, again, the rest of the accountant, made it hard for the trustees to justify expenditures for things like signage. So this is just existing monies and allows the library trustees to expend them for equipment as well as the building itself.
What's the number of dollars involved?
We'll have that, actually. I'll get that from Lauren, one of the trustees. It's not five digits. Anyway, I'll make sure there's a number there, Bob, or a number for the discussion. Next up is SCEMS, Article 20. We're into consent articles at that point.
Oh, and that's the one that we may not have to have, too.
Right.
Yep.
IMA one.
Right. Okay. We may end up passing that over, and then consent articles 21 through 27.
Motion to accept the motions as presented.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded on the motions. The recommendation as amended tonight. We have some handwriting here. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please.
Save us 20 votes.
Hey, it's all about efficiency in some cases. I would turn, before we adjourn tonight, I would turn, let me make sure that I'm on the agenda. Lacey, make sure I stay on the agenda, will I? Oh, all right. Well, we can do anything we want. We can ad lib. We can do all kinds of stuff.
You want mine?
Put it upstairs.
Yeah. So what we have, Bob, do you have a use of balance of use of cash sheets, balances, etc.?
Can I have that?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Go ahead. So the discussion about engineering, Tom and David, Mr. Moderator, the engineering services may well come out of, may be brought forward to come out of regular stabilization as opposed to capital stabilization. Okay. And the lease on the truck we have a range on, and the lease payments are completely legit to come out of capital stabilization because you have an asset you're dealing with at that point. Okay. The range there, if you look at those, may be an additional line here of up to 20, I didn't bring my book with me, no higher than $28,000. Depends on which truck. We have three trucks. We have three lease schedules. I would ask the board's consideration, the maximum lease is 7 years. Minimum lease, of course, is two. Mm-hmm. I would ask discussion about entering into a 7-year total lease. You're talking about a nearly $200,000 dump truck. They have a life cycle probably better than 7 years. Discussion, consideration?
So we've traditionally gotten much more than 7 years out mm-hmm. of them. So I think that's reasonable.
Okay. Tom, what do you think?
We can... I'd like to see some numbers. I'd like to actually see the numbers.
Yeah.
Before, so they can say, five, six, or seven. Sure. Okay.
We can put them together for analysis for Monday.
Yeah.
Okay. So those are the only two pieces on the capital that are currently missing. The engineering services was $67,000.
$63,686, I believe.
And then the truck variables, 2, 5, and 7, or 2, 3, and 7 year leases. So we'll have those for Monday for our use.
Was the holder 3 year? The whacker thing, was that 3 or 4?
It was 5.
Oh, was it 5 year?
Yeah. It was almost $100,000 when we were all said and done.
It was a lease to buy kind of deal, right?
Like over. Yeah, it was a lease to own. Yeah. The question about the leasing in general is, what do we do with a 7-year dump truck? Was discussion tonight at the Capitol Committee, what do you do with a 7-year dump truck? Is it a perpetual lease? Do you roll it over? Does it have value? Or is it an asset you purchase? And I think there's a really healthy discussion to have. Cruisers, pickup trucks, maybe.
They're usually... It's a lease with an option to purchase for
correct.
X number of dollars.
Correct.
At the end of the lease.
Right, at the end of the lease. Yeah. It's typical.
So we'll have those lease documents for the board. And really, that's the extent, unless there's anything to go over on the warrant and motions. That was our mission tonight, was to get the warrant signed and posted and to begin the discussion and hopefully substantively complete the discussion on the motions. Anything else?
We can talk about the parcels again.
No. We can talk about those. We're going to be here on Monday the 25th. And we're going to be here Monday the 25th at 6:30 with bells on. Everybody's going to wear bells. The 29th, that Friday, a week from this Friday, is everybody's chance to participate in your fundamental democratic right and go to town meeting.
All right.
May 7th, if you weren't registered to vote, you can't participate. That's the way it is in Massachusetts and most of the world. That town election is May 7th at the Sunderland Elementary School from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. And for those on the ballot, thank you for running. Anything else? If not, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. And thanks, FCAT, in particular, Lacey, for making a quick change and allowing the broadcast tonight. Thank you. 7:46, please. We get to say we're back. Actually, you get to do that. We need a director's clap. We're back. Right? Are we back?
Yeah.
We're back live.
You know,
Lacey brought us back. Tom had a request.
I just wanted to add one thing. On the Kinder Morgan thing, I just want to say one thing. It doesn't matter what my opinions or Scott's or David's, anybody's opinion. The fact is that there are 8 Franklin County towns that worked together to get a result. And I think sometimes what's missed, and we're having that conversation right now with our South County EMS, is that sometimes things aren't like they were 100 years ago, and we have to look beyond our own four corners, our borders, and I can guarantee without question that if the 8 towns didn't get together and do what they did together, Kinder Morgan would still be rolling over those towns.
I would agree with that.
That by working together, they have a better, they have a result that they want. And again, when I look at South County EMS, when I look at South County Senior Center, when I look at Frontier Regional, when I look at many things, when I look at FCAT, I don't want to forget FCAT. I can guarantee you that we wouldn't FCAT if we weren't doing it together. And that goes back to 15 years ago when we first started negotiations with Comcast, somebody looking and saying that we could work much, at that time it was very easy for Comcast to roll over an individual town, but it was somebody from Deerfield, his name is Mark Gilmore, who helped put Franklin County together to be able, or put our 4 towns together, and at the time really was Sunderland and Deerfield, that allowed us to get FCAT to where it is today. But it was looking together to build something. And again, I think that's important. And matter of fact, now it's going to be interesting what Berkshire Gas is going to do, because they have the moratorium on gas and stuff, which affects us. But it's amazing when you, again, to look at the 8 towns that got together, and I understand there was more, but I'm looking at just our little section, how 8 towns got together and were able to come together to make something happen. Those people, you have to give them a lot of credit that they were able to stand together and to do that. And it just goes to show, if we work together, the things that we can accomplish. So I'm sorry we had to come back for that.
No, but I think it's a good thing to come to.
I thought it was important.
That's good points. Good
Thank
points.
You.
In unity, there is strength.
Points. Interestingly enough...